students from Queen's University here in Belfast. Josh and I are part of the Public History MA program, and Cathal is part of the History MA program. And so we were contacted during the showcase by Adam. Several people came in to give pitches, like he said, from museums and historical sites and other charities. And we all really liked Adam's pitch, so we reached out to him. And one of the things he mentioned was going through the letters that are hosted here at PRONI from Cara-Friend from 1974 to 1985. So just to get a bit more into our actual project, we were looking at over 450 letters. It's actually quite a bit more than that, because the technical term, I suppose, would be items. We're looking at over 450 items, because if the charity received more than one letter from the same person, they would put them all together. And so what that really means is there's over 450 items, but there's several more letters than that. Some of them are quite huge, actually. So what we were doing is we were looking through them at Adam's request. We put them all in chronological order to the best of our ability. Obviously, with some of them, the stamps have faded, or we've lost the envelopes, and it's a bit of a guessing game. But as far as we could, they are put in chronological order, which was quite a journey. And we look through them to analyze them for different demographic data and look at the different themes that we're running across. And so we looked at things like gender orientation, sexual orientation, age, general location. So we were looking at the different counties, but also if there were any international letter writers. And these are the first correspondence letters. And so these were people primarily reaching out for things like making friends or receiving more information on Cara-Friend. And Josh and Cathal will speak more to that later. But one of the things that these letters really does is show more insight into the average life of an LGBT person in the 70s and 80s. Like Nadine was saying, which, thank you to Nadine, by the way, that was very helpful and very related to what we were doing, I think, as well. They really show how people felt. Some of the letters can be quite sad or distressing because the presentation is called Letters from a Lonely Place, and so some of the themes are really quite negative, but also I think it provides an idea into the subculture that existed, particularly in Belfast at the time, which is really interesting. You can get the sense that there really is a community and that people really are together in throughout this. And so, like I said, we looked at the quantitative and qualitative data throughout the different letters, put together the numbers as best as we could. And so now we'll get more into the content of that. Just before we get started, the presentation does contain some upsetting themes, and we won't go too deeply into them, but things like assault, loneliness, suicidal ideation do sort of come up at times, and so please take care of your own mental health. If you need to leave, please feel free to do so. And so now we'll get into the basics of Cara-Friend, which were mentioned earlier, but yes, it was created in 1974 as a voluntary organization to support lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender people across Northern Ireland, and it's modeled on earlier versions like a London Friend, and it is sort of flying under the radar, but there also seems to be quite a lot of community awareness of this. People are writing in their letters about having read about it in newspaper ads, heard it on radio programs, even if people don't exactly always have a clear idea of what it is, but they know that it exists. And so with that, I'm going to hand it over to Cathal to talk about the quantitative data.
Okay, so the archival records show that during the years between the 1970s and the 1980s, there were 450 letters received, 152 state their age, the youngest letter writer was 16, and six letters were written by people who were over the age of 55. So that's just our wee sort of tallies there. So in the age range 16 to 24, there were 74 people. So that's more or less the biggest age range. There was still people older than that writing, which I think is very interesting because it does show the scope of Cara-Friend was reaching people across age ranges, which is not something that you would necessarily have thought would have been happening, you know, in the age of the Mary White houses and that sort of thing. We also looked at the data by county. So as you can see, Antrim, a lot more of the letters were coming from the Antrim, specifically Belfast, which does make sense because most of the advertising would be coming from Belfast. It is a Belfast-based organisation at that time. There were 8 letters coming from Fermanagh, 33 from Tyrone, 24 from Derry, 26 from Armagh, and 40 from Down. So that sort of shows, again, a wide range of, I suppose you could say, lifestyles. The more rural counties of Derry or Tyrone, but contrasting that with people writing from Belfast, it does show just a wide range. Additionally, there were letters coming from international sources. There was 15 coming from North America, 1 from South America, 5 coming across Europe, and 1 from Asia. There was 1 from Africa as well, and 1 from Australia. There was also 27 letters coming from Great Britain. I think it was mostly Scotland though, and there was 22 from the Republic. So, who was writing the Cara-Friend? Letters were overwhelmingly sent in by the LGBT plus individuals, which makes sense. Some social and health and services personnel, as well as university societies and non-LGBT individuals. It's difficult to use modern phraseology and terminology when discussing the LGBT plus individuals during the 70s and 80s, simply because they may not describe themselves as we would describe ourselves now, and also we can't exactly say what someone's identity was. Of the 450 plus letters written to Cara-Friend, there are married individuals, professionals, students, parents, widows, and organisations. Many wrote expressing their struggles with their sexual orientation and gender, or gender identity. Again, that's just a really wide scope of people, which does show just how the Cara-Friend was able to provide services for people. Reasons for contacting Cara-Friend. Within the 450 plus letters, the reasons for making contact included people looking to befriending services, seeking relationships, wanting to meet new people, even looking for pen pals or accommodation. And there was 184 of these letters with these sort of purposes. There's 245 letters of people requesting information, support, or just looking to speak to someone. And specifically related to loneliness or depression, there was about 55 letters. And there was 10 letters which had mentions of suicide, but we won't really delve into those sort of. On a more positive note, there was 60 letters sort of discussed the subculture and queer culture of the bars, discos and clubs and societies. So it does show that there was people seeking out these sorts of outlets for their expression of gender and sexuality at this time. It's also worth noting that some of these letters tick more than one of these boxes and some letters don't tick any of them. Okay, so now I'm going to turn it over to Josh.
Hi, I'm Josh. So when we were looking at the qualitative data, I asked Adam to look at his 2019 presentation that he did, and the first quote popped up here that I think that everyone at Cara-Friend is doing a terrific job, and I wish you all the best for the future, and I hope you overcome any obstacles that is ignorant society throws towards you. And we were reading the letters, we came across this little quote that says, I'm sure many people will thank you one day for your pioneering effort. Even external forces should limit your apparent short-term success, which heaven forbid. And I think that marries in really well with the project that we set out to do, the community project, and with ongoing successes that hopefully this project will be a springboard for. So let's get into some of the qualifiers. I'm just aware of the time. So first one is finding a friend. This one does mention loneliness, depression, and suicide. The youngest letter writer we had was a 16-year-old, and the majority of letters that can claim or did pertain to loneliness and depression were people from rural communities, and they often felt ostracized and they felt like they were the only people there. They felt they had no one to talk to, and due to this, most of them couldn't drive and couldn't get into Belfast, and so there was a real drive for Cara-Friend volunteers to meet people in places like Strabane, people like who couldn't get into Belfast or have access to other befriending services. And the second one, when it says, I'm writing in total desperation for my plight for 10 years now. I have been very attracted to other men. I hope you can help me. There's got me to the stages where like, I am contemplating suicide. Whenever we were going through it, we noticed that a lot of the names were redacted, and that is for privacy. And so at the top of the letter you will see that Cara-Friend has responded and it says that information has been given. Unfortunately though, it could just be one letter, and so we can see any follow-up correspondence. So it does sort of put a bit of a hamper on further research and digging to make sure that person is okay, but whenever information has been provided, we assume that everything has been grand and everything is going swimmingly. And with the bottom one, I wonder if you could offer advice in relation to my own particular form of loneliness. This was a man who worked as a teacher. He originally trained as an architect, and then he went to live in London. He worked there, and then he moved to Dublin and became a teacher. But his main expression is that he wanted to be art, but he couldn't because of the interviews of being a teacher. As a gay male teacher in the 1970s and 80s, you would be banned as a sex offender or as a paedophile. And he was found to Cara-Friend to see what it seems like in Belfast, and to see it would be more of an accepting and open place. We mentioned international letters, and one of the most interesting things that I came across was there was a letter from a lady who lived in Canada for a while, and she was saying when she lived in Canada it was much more open, it was more free, people could enjoy themselves more, and she was an expat. So whenever she came back to Northern Ireland, she was a lesbian, she was open about it, but whenever she came back here she had to hide that part of herself, and because she didn't want to lose friends and she didn't want to lose family, and so she was writing to Cara-Friend again just to see what information she could glean. And with many of the letters, whenever they were seeking information, it was often a caveat of I'm seeking information because I'm lonely or I'm depressed. Just like we said, many of them picked more than one box. Oh yeah, and that was a mail from 1997. So similar nature. So as Indeed has said, it was hard to find people who were either identified as bisexual or trans. In this archive, a lot of people identified as homosexual, and because of the names have been redacted, we couldn't ascertain whether or not they were male or female, so we just sort of had to like go with what was written. But we did find some people who did identify as trans, and Cara-Friend would write back saying that there was meetings on Thursdays in Belfast and that they should come along. And if they were nervous or they needed help, that there would be a friend there who could come with them and would help support them. There's also mention a lot of the gay president writes, or the gay president of the student union writes to Cara-Friend a lot also. And we've got a lot of letters from students who say whenever they were walking through campus, they would see a stall for the gay society at Queen's, but they were too nervous to approach because perhaps maybe they were with their friends and they didn't want to be judged. And so they would often write after the fact, which is the second one here, that I assume if you've been, I'm excited to come to see if I can give you any information to live a life as gay or as a bisexual man. Many people vote for information, that could be information regarding any of the services previously mentioned in the previous slides or even in the Dean slide, and also for befriending services, and this is particularly relevant in more rural areas. You might call this butches, subculture, and socialising. So the first quote is from two women who were in the army, and they came to Belfast and they were wanting to know more about the scene in Belfast, and they wanted to see that they could go up to while they were here. We noticed that a lot of the people were willing to they were willing to get the bus down to Belfast and try and look for accommodations so they could stay till. So they go to the Belfast disco or scene for the night and then go back. Let's get into that bit. Quick drink, one sec. So the last person, he was very disgruntled, he was not happy.
He would have been frisked.
Pardon?
He would have been frisked.
Yes. So we're not entirely sure how he managed to miss all the soldiers during this time, but he was very upset that there was no British soldiers. In some of the letters there is mention of sex, and there's mention of sex workers, but we didn't want to delve into that just too much because we thought it was more prevalent issues such as issues of rural and urbanization, loneliness, and where these letters were coming from. So that perhaps maybe would be something to look at later on. But just for the time being, we wanted to focus on maybe a bit more of a different avenue. Also, a lot of the correspondence, a lot of people are poets, and you wouldn't even know it. Sorry. There we go. So the first one was from an American correspondent. And Irish, Irish everywhere, here in America, and there at home, never at rest, just wanting to be alone. Why always we are right, so we must fight. But wait, you are not alone. In America, it is what is black must not be white. That is a very redacted version. I do have the full version on me. It's very long, so I couldn't put it on the whole slide, because we did have three examples of poetry. The second one, that one was a bit confusing, wasn't it, Lily? That one, yeah, it was kind of more like a play. It was kind of like Shakespearean play. Sisters, and then it was incest involved. And they wanted that one to be published. I'm not entirely sure if it did. I don't think it did. My Cara-Friend did a very court response, but it was like, information was provided, and that was it. So they did their job. And then other ones were quite, were more emotional, was just trying to say, like, you know, we feel guilty about how we, my upbringing and how my sexuality was wrong, but at the same time, my love for this person, you know, is valid and it's real. And someone put in their letters a rose or a garden beautiful. So definitely battling inner demons there and two sides of the same coin. But there were other interesting things we came across. And school reports and dissertations on the LGBT community. So we had people writing mainly from the UK, so Scotland and England, and they were wanting to know how people in Rhode Island were being treated compared to their mainland counterparts. Donations and bequeathals. We do come across some £5 donations, and with the bequeathal, we did come across a man who wanted to get in contact with Cara-Friend just to see what he could give them with his time to go laws. There was a man who wanted a directory of clubs and bars to serve LGBT plus people. Again, Cara-Friend actually did a very in detailed report back with that one. And so I think they collaborated a little bit because it seemed because the item was quite large, it was quite thick. And one of the things that did pop up quite a lot was people who identified as Christian and also wanted to get in contact with other gay Christian fellowships. We couldn't find any particular denomination. It was quite tricky to do that, and again, Cara-Friend pointed them in the right direction of where they needed to go. There was some confusion over the name. There was a particular instance where a man was looking for a coloured friend, and he must have heard a radio announcement. He says in that he heard the radio announcement that he wants to know if he can meet a coloured female. And you know, he was an older man. I think he was 55 plus. So he, you know, there was just genuine confusion over that. There was also supports from the LGBT protests. That one was pertaining to the protest at the Greek embassy in Dublin. People were asking about marriage and adoption laws. There was a man imported down who owned a paint shop, and he wanted if there was any gay people looking for a job, imported down. So yeah, and there was also a wide variety of background. We had one skinhead who he wrote in. Again, rural areas where they were quite prevalent. They seemed to higher areas of more mental health. Atheists wrote in, international visitors, and there was also that, teachers as well. You must be aware of my hoaxes and hate mail. So whenever we were coming across the archives, we came across hoaxes and hate mail, and we didn't originally know what to do with them, so we just set them aside, because whenever you're reading through these archives, and they are quite triggering anyway, because they can be quite emotive, the last thing you want is to have, you know, Christian theology rammed down your throat, and you know, just in a hateful way. You don't want that. So we decided to put that into its own folder alongside Cara-Friend archives,
So they can be accessed, and most of them are biblical based. But one man, which we thought was quite funny, was that he mentioned the ancient Greeks, and I mean they would guess that was all. So I don't really know what his stamina was, but yes. And then so now we're going to talk about our individual experiences. And Lily is first.
Thank you, Josh. Yeah, so as Josh was saying, there's quite a lot of letters from a lot of really different backgrounds, which was very interesting to read. In particular, I was really interested in the letters from gay and bisexual women. There aren't quite as many, not nearly as there are from men of all persuasions, but part of that is due to the fact that there was a lesbian line, which we did not go through the records of that, but that is also here in PRONI. So the letters that we went through were just from women that happened to write to the first correspondents at Cara-Friend. And I found it really interesting also how many people were writing with an interest in legislation and protest and how to basically move the LGBT agenda forward. So there were people writing for all different sorts of reasons, wanting to ask about, particularly from international writers, what is the situation with marriage over there? What is the situation with, can I get employment? Can I get accommodation over there without being discriminated against? That sort of thing. In particular, there was one letter from a woman who was a lesbian and was thinking about moving to Belfast, and she wrote using the social and health services, which sent over quite a few letters, which I thought was very interesting. And she wrote over asking, is it possible to come over to Belfast, live here as an open lesbian, and adopt children? Mm-hmm. And we don't have the exact reply that Cara-Friend sent, but we do have the notations that Josh mentioned that they take at the top, which just said discouraged. which I mean, at least they were honest, you know. So yeah, in particular, I think it's really interesting to look at the people that didn't send quite so many letters. So like women, people that identified as transvestites, that sort of thing. In particular, there was a letter from a person who said they were a man, but also felt like a woman trapped in a man's body. And so it's kind of hard to ascribe a concrete identity to that sort of thing, because they do say they're a man, but they also talk about being transvestite for a great portion of the letter. And they were writing asking if there were any lesbians who would be willing to live with them. And they're not really very concrete about whether or not that's in platonic or other circumstances. But it was a really interesting letter to read. This was an older person in the 55 plus bracket, which there weren't a lot of, but it was really interesting to see. And certainly there weren't any letters that identified themselves as being from people over, I would think, the age of 60. Mm-hmm. There was no one above that. And so that seems particularly interesting given what we were talking about, say, with people over the age of 80 in nursing homes, that sort of thing. So, but of course you have to remember that a lot of the letters, people don't identify what age they are, they don't say much of anything about themselves. They might describe what they're looking for in a person that they're hoping to meet, but they don't talk as much about, you know, who they are, how they identify, because again, a lot of that I think is implied with the names and that sort of thing, which a lot of times have been redacted. But it's been really interesting overall. I think we've all really enjoyed it. And so now I'm gonna pass it back to Josh.
So I chose to do this internship because as a young gay white man in Belfast, my experiences are wholly different from the people who wrote these letters. And I also want to work in between two institutions. I wanted to work with a charity, and I also wanted to work with a accredited archive services like PRONI, and so I thought the best of both worlds, perfect. My time here has been invaluable. I've learned so many new skills in terms of indexing, cataloguing, transcribing, and even pulling out relevant information, and even the minute details that you would have maybe overlooked. So if you don't know where the letter's from, you look at the postage stamp, you're like, aha, gotcha. So you feel like a detective, and you're very much like whittling down in order to get the grand narrative off the whole the project that you're trying to achieve. I was very interested in the people who were writing in. You did get the people who maybe who said, like, you know, I'm 25 now and I want to, I've tried being straight, but I want to go gay. So you're like, okay, so those feelings have been there, but you know, the terminology is just, you know, not correct. And you know, we look at people who are perhaps maybe already even on behalf of bullying or gay. There was one letter, and she ran a hostel, and she, there was two young men with, I think they were both 17, and they both identified as gay, but she wrote to Cara-Friend on behalf and said that she was worried for them. And Cara-Friend wrote a reply saying, well, they're both 17, they come back to us now, do you mean, you know, it's better if we talk to them directly because we don't want anything to be misconstrued and misinterpreted. Other interesting letters that I found were, there is some problematic elements in that because there are people who do display mental health issues. There is a long series of correspondences, one particular one, and his name's Reggie, and he's very problematic. He notes his attraction to younger men, particularly young boys, teenager boys, and he's 17, but he goes so far and he actually changes his handwriting to pretend he's writing to someone else, but the Cara-Friend people know that it's him. And so eventually they get to the stage where they just stop applying because they're just like, we keep applying, we're just going to keep fueling this predatory and like mental health behaviour. And they tried to say, like, we'll make a befriend her, and he kept putting it off and putting it off and putting it off. So eventually they were just like, right, we've done our bit, you know, this is out of our even now, you know, you need to keep going to the doctor, actually. But yeah, no, there has been challenges, especially with the name redactions, and so it has been hard to move on picture, and especially when there are gaps with people who identify as bisexual or trans. We did have one person who identified as biphilic, which surprised us, because I don't know what biphilic is. So there we go, it's a learning experience for me.
What is it?
It's a very
loving oath.
Oh, yes, yeah, for
sure. Sorry, I remember this letter from reading it. It was a letter from an older gentleman. He doesn't say his age, but we know he's older because he describes both of his children have gone to university. And he's been with his wife, but they've been, I think the phrase he uses is that she sexually left him for quite a long time. And so he describes himself as biphilic and basically says he wants a relationship with a man that is anything but sex.
I'm excited to see what this project can lead to, and the hopeful researchers that come in the future, and hopefully our groundwork has been useful and we haven't hit a whole licks at the whole thing.
As you can see, there I am. My name is Cathal McGuigon, and for transgender men, I have stayed away from LGBT history. I think I said to my module convener, I'd been lost on anything but the history of Gaelic football for quite some time. But when I heard about what Cara-Friend was offering for the module, I thought this is going to be fantastic to be involved in. This is really interesting. Local history in particular fascinates me. But also, as we may have said before, these two are the public history masters. I'm not. I'm a simple history master. And so I'm sort of the interloper. And it's been a good experience. In straight history, we don't very much get as much access with the documents and original documents. So it's been brilliant seeing that bit of real history, people's experiences, and you're holding it in your hand. That's something that you can't get very much from sitting in a library for hours, that you can get if you come down here and look at their stuff. But it's been an amazing experience. These two, really lovely. everyone at Cara-Friend and everyone down here at PRONI has been very welcoming and very understanding, and they show us how to do everything. It's probably been the best best thing with my master's experience so far. I don't really say much for master's experience, but these are all brilliant. just looking through physical history, that's been amazing. And I'm only recently on TV, so I'm not used to my voice, so I'm going to this. Thank you. MA in Public History at QUB. You can see it there. Lily and Josh did takeover days, as did some of the other public history students on their internships. So have a wee nosy at that, and you can see some of the projects that QUB has been sending us off on. Thank you very much.